I welcome you all in this presentation. In this lecture, we'll discuss about assumptions in Reynolds equation, then derivation of Reynolds equation for two-dimensional flow as well as one-dimensional flow. Then we'll see different types of hydrodynamic journal bearings based on L by D ratios. Then we'll see design variables as well as performance variables for hydrodynamic journal bearings. And finally, we'll discuss about selection of design variables for hydrodynamic journal bearing.
Contents of this lecture are Reynolds equation. We'll be seeing the derivation of Reynolds equation for hydrodynamic lubrication. Types of hydrodynamic journal bearings. Design considerations in hydrodynamic journal bearings. And selection of bearing design variables. So let us see Reynolds equation for hydrodynamic lubrication. The theoretical analysis of the hydrodynamic lubrication was first done by Osborne Reynold in 1886. The fundamental equation devised by him is popularly known as Reynolds equation for hydrodynamic lubrication. Now this equation is based on certain assumptions. So let us see what are the assumptions he made in deriving this equation. So the Reynolds equation is based on following assumptions. First, the lubricant obeys Newton's law of viscosity. Second, the inertia forces of the lubricant are neglected. Third, the flow of the lubricant is laminar. Fourth, the lubricant is incompressible. Fifth, the viscosity of the lubricant is constant throughout the film. The pressure of the lubricant is constant in the direction of the film thickness, that is del P by del Y is equal to 0. There is continuous supply of the lubricant. And eighth one is, the fluid film is so thin in comparison with the bearing radius that the effect of curvature is neglected. So let us see the derivation of this equation, Reynolds equation for two-dimensional flow. Let us consider a journal rotating in anticlockwise direction with a constant surface velocity capital U and supported by a fluid film of lubricant having variable thickness H. So this is the figure showing this red part is bearing and this black part is journal which is rotating in anticlockwise direction with a speed n, and in this annular space the lubricant is provided. Now for the analysis, we are considering a small portion of lubricating film having length dx and height dy, and h is nothing but the fluid film thickness between this shaft and journal at this instant. So, as discussed earlier, let us consider a small fluid element having dimensions dx, dy and dz along x, y and z directions respectively in the converging zone as shown in below figure. Here, x axis represents the direction of the flow, y axis represents radial direction and z axis is parallel to the journal axis. So this is the figure showing the small fluid element. From PP dash is the inlet where flow is coming in, and QQ dash is the exit from where the flow is coming out. And here we have considered a small fluid element having the dimensions dx, dy and dz. This red surface is a stationary surface, whereas this green surface is rotating surface with a velocity capital U, and this is the H is nothing but the instantaneous or local film thickness at this particular instance. Also, consider u, v and w be the components of general velocity in x, y and z directions respectively. So, let us see the first step, pressure gradient and velocity distribution of the fluid. Let us consider the forces acting on the fluid element in x direction. So, let us consider this yellow portion is nothing but a lubricating film which is having dimensions dx, dy and dz as discussed earlier. So, we will be having two kind of forces which will act on this lubricating film. One is the force because of the pressure of the fluid and second is because of the shear stress. So, let us see how to estimate these forces. So, in the direction of the flow, we will have pressure force equal to P, where P is the pressure, into dy into dz. The flow is coming in from this. So, the area is dy into dz. So, this area multiplied by the magnitude of the pressure. So, that will give us the pressure force equal to P into dy into dz. Now, the pressure force on the other side or at the exit will be equal to the pressure at the inlet plus the pressure gradient developed over the length of the fluid dx. So, that can be estimated as P plus del P by del x, that is nothing but the pressure gradient which is developed over the length of dx, that multiplied by the length dx. So, this will give us the increase in pressure over the length dx. So, P plus del P by del x into dx, this is the total pressure at this end and this multiplied by again the area, that is equal to dy into dz. So, this is the pressure which is acting on the other side of the lubricating element. Now, let us see how this shear force will act. So, shear force is tau x is nothing but a shear stress in x direction. So, shear stress multiplied by area. Now, shear stress will act parallel in the direction parallel to the surface. So, the area on which it is acting is dx into dz. So, dx into dz, that is area multiplied by tau x, that will give us the shear force acting on the bottom surface. Please remember this surface is stationary. So, therefore, shear force will act in the direction opposite. Now, the shear force acting on the top will be the shear stress developed over the length dy into the area of the cross section. So, tau x is the shear stress which is on the bottom surface. Now, the shear stress developed over the length dy will be del tau x into del y, that is shear stress gradient, that multiplied by the height dy or the length we can say dy. So, that will give us the increase in shear stress. So, the total shear stress acting on the top surface of the lubricant element will be tau x plus del tau x upon del y into dy. This is the total shear stress multiplied by the area of the surface, that is dx into dz. So, therefore, this shear stress force or the shear force will act in the direction of the flow of the lubricant. So, the various forces acting are, let us summarize these forces. First, the fluid pressure force P into dy into dz in positive x direction, that is direction of the flow. Second, fluid pressure force P plus del P by del x into dx into dy into dz in negative x direction. Third, shear force on bottom surface, that is tau x into dx into dz in negative x direction. And fourth one, shear force on top surface, which is tau x plus del tau x upon del y into dx into dz in positive x direction. Now let us consider equilibrium of these forces in x direction. Therefore, we have P into dy into dz plus the shear force on the top surface tau x plus delta x upon del y into dy into dx into dz minus tau x into dx into dz minus P plus del P by del x into dx into dy into dz is equal to 0. We have considered the forces acting summation of fx is equal to 0. This condition, if we implement, we get this equation A. Now, expanding the terms in the bracket, we get P into dy into dz plus tau x into dx into dz plus del tau x upon del y into dy into dx into dz minus tau x into dx into dz minus P into dy into dz minus P del P by del x into dx into dy into dz, that is equal to 0. Now cancelling out the similar terms, we get del P by del x is equal to del tau x upon del y. Let us consider this as equation B. Now according to Newton's law of viscosity, we have tau x, that is shear stress in x direction, that is equal to mu into du upon dy. Let us consider this as equation C. Now substituting equation C in equation B, we get del P by del x equal to del by del y of mu into du by dy. So therefore, we get del P by del x is equal to mu into del square u upon del y square. Let us consider this as equation D. So this equation D gives us pressure gradient in x direction. The pressure gradient in y direction is del P by del y is equal to 0. According to assumption number 6, we have considered there is no flow in the lateral direction. So del P by del y is equal to 0. Let us consider this as equation number E. Now the pressure gradient in z direction, the forces in yz plane are as below. So let us consider this fluid element having the same dimension dx, dy and dz in the direction of respective axis. So the pressure force acting P into dx into dy, here now it will be dx into dy. Similarly on the other side, it will be P plus the pressure developed over the length dz. So that is del P by del z into dz into the area dx into dy. So we have the pressure force equal to P plus del P by del z into dz into dx into dy. Now next is shear stress. So shear stress will be tau z with the shear stress acting in z direction, that multiplied by the area dx into dz. Now here area will be dx into dz. So this area multiplied by tau z, that will give us shear force on bottom surface. Now shear force on top surface will be shear stress developed into area. So that shear stress developed will be tau z, which is acting on the bottom surface, plus the shear stress gradient developed over the length dy. So it will be del tau z upon del y, that is shear stress gradient, that multiplied by dy, that will give us the shear stress increase in shear stress in y direction. So total will be tau z plus del tau z upon del y into dy into the area dx into dz. So considering equilibrium of forces in z direction and simplifying similar to the equations in x direction, the pressure gradient in z direction can be given as del P by del z is equal to mu into del square w upon del y square. Let us consider this as equation F. Now let us consider the pressure gradient in x direction only. That is, del P by del x is equal to mu into del square u upon del y square. Now rearranging, we have del square u upon del y square, that is equal to 1 upon mu into del p by del x. Now integrating this equation with respect to y, we get du by dy is equal to 1 upon mu into del p by del x into y plus a, which is the constant of integration. Once again integrating with respect to y, we get u, that is velocity in x direction, velocity component in x direction, equal to 1 by twice of mu into del p by del x into y square plus a into y plus b. Again, b is the constant of integration. Let us consider this equation as g. Now, these constants of integrations a and b are estimated using following boundary conditions. At y is equal to 0, that is at a stationary surface, we have velocity is equal to 0, and at y is equal to h, that means at the moving surface, upper surface, we have velocity is equal to capital U. So, substituting these values in equation g, we get b is equal to 0 and u is equal to 1 upon twice of mu into del p by del x into h square plus a into h plus 0. So, therefore, value of the constant of integration a is u by h minus h upon 2 mu into del p by del x. Substituting these values of a and b in equation g, we have u is equal to 1 upon twice of mu into del p by del x into y square plus u by h minus h by twice of mu into del p by del x into y plus 0. So, therefore, u is equal to 1 upon twice of mu into del p by del x into y square minus hy plus u by h into y. Let us consider this as equation h. Now, in this equation h, we have this first term 1 upon twice of mu into del p by del x into y square minus hy. In this part, we have this del p by del x, that is nothing but the pressure gradient. So, this part of the velocity is nothing but the partially flow term due to pressure gradient. So, this term is dominated because of this pressure gradient. So, this term is known as partially flow term, and that is because of the pressure gradient. Whereas, the second term, we can see this u is nothing but the surface velocity of the shaft. So, this term is dominated by the self rotation of the shaft, which is known as cot flow term due to motion of the journal. This above equation h gives the velocity distribution of the lubricant as a function of y and pressure gradient del p by del x in x direction. Now, let us estimate flow rate of the fluid. The flow rate of the fluid qx in x direction per unit width in z direction is given as. Now, this qx is nothing but velocity into area. So, velocity in x direction is u and area is dy into dz. Now, we have considered this dz as unity. So, therefore, we will have qx is equal to area into velocity. Now, velocity is u, area is dy into dz. Now, since we have considered this dz as unity, we have this qx, that is flow in x direction, as u into 1 into dy, and the variation of this will be from 0 to h, since 0 is the fluid film thickness at stationary surface, whereas h is the fluid film thickness at upper surface. So, this h varies along y. So, the limits of integration will be 0 to h, and therefore, qx will be equal to integration of u into dy varying from 0 to h. Now, substituting the value of u from equation h in the earlier equation, mu get qx is equal to integration of 1 upon twice of mu into del p by del x into y square minus hy plus u by h into y, the whole bracket multiplied by dy, and this will vary from 0 to h. So let us consider this equation as I. Now solving, we get this as qx is equal to minus h cube upon 12 mu into del p by del x plus u into h by 2. So this is the flow in x direction. Similarly, the flow rate of the fluid in z direction, that is qz per unit width in x direction, is given as qz is equal to minus of hq divided by 12 mu into del p by del z, that is the pressure gradient in z direction, plus wv into h by 2, where wv is nothing but the component of the velocity in z direction. Let us consider this as equation j. So therefore, Reynolds equation. Now the continuity equation for steady state with incompressible lubricant can be given as del qx upon del x plus del qy upon del y plus del qz upon dz is equal to 0. Now as there is no flow in y direction, we have del qy upon del y is equal to 0. Therefore, substituting this value of del qy by del y is equal to 0 and values of qx and qz from equations I and j in above continuity equation, we have del upon del x of minus h cube upon 12 mu into del p by del x plus u into h by 2 plus del by del z of minus h cube upon 12 mu into del p by del z plus wv into h by 2 is equal to 0. So rearranging the terms, we get del by del x of h cube upon 12 mu into del p by del x plus del by del z of h cube upon 12 mu into del p by del z, that is equal to del by del x of u into h by 2 plus del by del z of wv into h by 2. So finally, we get the equation as del by del x of h cube into del p by del x plus del by del z of h cube into del p by del z, that is equal to 6 mu into del by del x of u into h plus del by del z of wv into h. Let us consider this equation as k. This equation is known as Reynolds equation for two dimensional flow. Now, as the velocities u and wv are not function of x and z respectively, and again viscosity of the lubricant mu is constant according to assumption number 5, the above equation k can be modified as del by del x of h cube into del p by del x plus del by del z of h cube into del p by del z, that is equal to 6 mu into u into dh by dx plus wv into dh by dz. Now it is almost very rare to have a system in which the wedge h vary in both the direction, that is x and z. Therefore, we have del by del x of h cube into del p by del x plus del by del z of h cube into del p by del z, that is equal to 6 mu u into dh by dx. Let us consider this as equation m. This equation m is simplified Reynolds equation for two dimensional flow. If the bearing is infinitely long and there is no flow in z direction, then we have del p by del z is equal to 0. Therefore, substituting this, equation m becomes del by del x of h cube into del p by del x, that is equal to 6 mu u into dH by dx. This is Reynolds equation for one dimensional flow. Now let us see different types of hydrodynamic journal bearings. Based on the length to diameter ratio of the bearing, the hydrodynamic journal bearings are classified into three types. First, infinitely long journal bearings. Second, infinitely short, which are also called as narrow journal bearings. And third one, finite length journal bearings. Now let us see each type of bearing one by one. So first, infinitely long journal bearings. In infinitely long journal bearings, the length of the bearing in an axial direction is assumed to be infinite. Hence, there is no flow of the fluid in an axial direction, that is z direction. The journal bearings with length to diameter, that is L by D ratio, greater than 2 are considered as infinitely long journal bearings. Second, infinitely short, also known as narrow journal bearings. In infinitely short journal bearings, the length of the bearing in an axial direction is very short. Hence, there is considerable flow of fluid in an axial direction, that is z direction. The journal bearings having L by D ratio, that is length to diameter ratio, less than 0.5 are considered as infinitely short or narrow journal bearings. Third type, finite length journal bearings. The journal bearings with length to diameter ratio between 0.5 and 2 are considered as finite length journal bearings. Most of the hydrodynamic bearings used in practice fall in this category. The analysis of this category of the bearings is carried out using numerical solution of Reynolds equation. Like Boyd and Raimondi method we have, which is commonly used for analysis of such kind of bearings. Now let us see design considerations in hydrodynamic journal bearings. The variables used in the design of hydrodynamic journal bearings are categorized into two groups. The first is design variables and second is performance variables. So let us see design variables. The design variables are those whose values are either given or are under the control of the designer. The design variables used in hydrodynamic journal bearing design are, first, the viscosity of the lubricant mu, second, unit bearing pressure or load per projected unit projected area, that is small p, third is journal speed ns, and fourth one, bearing dimensions, that is r, radius of the shaft, clearance space capital C, and length of the bearing capital L. Now let us see performance variables. The performance variables are those which will tell us how the bearing is performing, or in other words, these are nothing but output parameters. The performance variables used in the hydrodynamic journal bearing design are, first, coefficient of friction F. Second, temperature right delta T. Third one, flow rate of the lubricant Q. And fourth one, minimum oil film thickness H0. The designer do not have any control over these parameters. Now let us see selection of bearing design variables. Many a times in the designing of hydrodynamic journal bearings, it is very much necessary to select the suitable values of the following variables. First is L by D ratio, that is length to diameter ratio. Second, unit bearing pressure small p. Third, radial clearance capital C. And fourth one, minimum oil film thickness H0. So let us see length to diameter ratio, L by D ratio. The length of the length to diameter ratio, that is L by D ratio, affects the performance of the bearing. Large L by D ratios, like in case of long bearings, reduce the side leakage and hence require less oil flow. They have high load carrying capacity and low coefficient of friction. However, as the oil flow is less, the temperature rises more in such kind of bearings. Long bearings are more susceptible to metal to metal contact at edges when the shaft is deflected under the load. Since there is a less amount of lubricating oil is required, it is prone to have a friction or metal to metal contact, and therefore when the shaft is deflected under the load, the metal to metal contact occurs at the edges and we have the friction, which in turn gives rise to temperature. Small L by D ratios, as in case of short bearings, results in a greater side leakage, thus keeping the bearings cooler. But these kind of bearings have high coefficient of friction and low load carrying capacity. In practice, L by D ratio varies from 0.5 to 2, but in majority of application, it is taken as unity or 1. The L by D ratio is increased if boundary lubrication is likely to take place and decreased for full film lubrication or higher temperatures. The effect of L by D ratio on pressure distribution is as shown in below figure. So, if the L by D ratio is more, we can have the more distribution of the pressure over the length, whereas in short journal bearings, we do not have much uniform pressure distribution over the length of the bearing. Second, unit bearing pressure, small p. The permissible value of unit bearing pressure depends upon the bearing material, the nature of the load, and operating temperature. So, the list of permissible values of unit bearing pressure for different application is given in this table. So, this table lists applications and unit bearing pressure values. Next, for different materials, the permissible values of unit bearing pressure are listed in this table. So, there are different bearing materials like lead based Babbitt. We have unit bearing pressure equal in the range of 4.2 to 5.6 newtons per millimeter square. In tin based Babbitt, we have 5.6 to 7. In copper lead, where we have 55% copper and 45% lead, we have unit bearing pressure, permissible value of unit bearing pressure in the range of 14 to 21. In case of copper lead tin, where we have 72% copper, 25% lead and 3% tin, the permissible value of unit bearing pressure ranges from 21 to 28. In case of silver, we have 35 and in case of bronze, we have 70. Next parameter is radial clearance, capital C. The radial clearance should be small to provide the necessary velocity gradient. Increase in radial clearance decreases the load carrying capacity and thus increases the oil flow rate. The various values of radial clearance for different bearings are listed in below table. So, we have for precision bearings, the radial clearance is taken in the range of 0.001 times radius of the shaft to 0.0015 times R. For general machinery bearings, it is ranging from 0.0015R to 0.0025R, and for rough service bearings, it ranges from 0.003 times R to 0.004 times R. And the last parameter is minimum oil film thickness, H0. The minimum oil film thickness is very important variable which governs the load carrying capacity and frictional loss of the bearing. The minimum permissible oil film thickness depends upon the surface finish, the viscosity of the lubricant and nature of the load. There is lower limit for the minimum oil film thickness below which there may be a metal to metal contact, which is given by the equation H0 equal to 0.0002 minus 0.0003 times R.
I will summarize this presentation. In this presentation, we have discussed assumptions in the Reynolds equation. Then we have seen the derivation of two-dimensional Reynolds equation as well as one-dimensional Reynolds equation for hydrodynamic lubrication. Then we have seen the types of hydrodynamic bearings based on L by D ratios. Then we have seen the performance variables and the design variables for hydrodynamic journal bearings. And finally, we have discussed about the selection of design variables for hydrodynamic design of hydrodynamic journal bearing. Thank you for your attention.